morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome. We have heating. Oh, we're so grateful to Alan and the plumber for getting this organised. There is prayer ministry available after this service. If you need prayer for anything, just come to the prayer place and there will be refreshments in the hall. At 6 o'clock this evening, we meet for prayer for Israel and the Jewish people. And at 6:30, also in the hall, is our evening service. On Monday, the Worthing Home Group meet at Alan and Dorothy's at 2:30 p.m. And at 7 p.m. here, Emmanuel, St. Margaret's and ourselves are meeting. We will begin with tea and coffee, then have a time of worship and prayer. It's anticipated that we'll finish around 8:30. On Tuesday, Friendship and Fun meet at 2 o'clock. On Wednesday, our deacons are meeting at 9:30, and our weekly prayer meeting is at 2 p.m. here in the prayer place. November news sheets are on the table in the foyer. Please take. I have a couple of advance notices. On Saturday, the 25th of November, we have a coffee morning in aid of Elam Ministries. There is a poster on the notice boards in the hall that will tell you what Elam Ministries does. And on Sunday, the 26th of November, we are having Cafe Church, beginning at 4 p.m. with tea and coffee. And around 4:30, we will have a time of worship. I shall be leading this and giving my testimony. So please prayerfully consider who you could invite to come. I now hand you over to Pastor David.
Thanks very much, Polly. Good morning and welcome. Good to see you all. Good to see you. It's good that it's warm, isn't it? Yes. Just to mention, this evening's service is a participatory service. It's one where we want to encourage those present to contribute reflections based on scripture, testimony, or other spiritual gifts. There will also be open prayer and worship of the Lord through song interlaced with these sort of contributions. So you'd be very welcome to come along this evening. And again, tomorrow evening's joint prayer meeting. It's the first time we've been able to do something as three churches together for a very long time. I think before COVID was the last time we had a joint prayer meeting. It's the first time I've had a joint prayer meeting since COVID and so on. I'm really encouraging you to come along tomorrow. The 7 o'clock is for coffee and refreshments. Doors open then. And then we actually start the prayer meeting proper at 7:30. And it will be in here. So, these words from Deuteronomy 7 verse 9, "Know the Lord your God is God. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments." And then these words from Romans 8, 38 and 39, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord." Well, today is Remembrance Sunday, and we will remember those who have served and died in war. The 2-minute silence will take place at 11 o'clock, and we will pray for peace and for those who work for peace. We will pray for the victims of war, civilians, refugees, and all brutalized by violence. Our opening hymn is "There Is a Green Hill Far Away," and we focus on the cross as we sing this hymn. It's number 674.
Who died?
let us pray. O God, our Creator, Father and Friend, we give thanks for the wonderful gift of life, with all its joys and responsibilities, its experiences and opportunities. We praise you for good health and daily food, for the shelter and care of our homes, and the love and loyalty of our friends. We thank you for the teaching and example of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for the forgiveness and salvation we have received through him, for his presence with us always, and for the service into which he has called us. Help us to express our thanks, not only in our praises and prayers, but also through the lives we lead. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let's continue in prayer. O Father, as we remember this morning those who gave their lives so we could be free, help us to remember your Son left his glory for the sorrow of mankind. He gave his life on the cross so that we could know your salvation and be free indeed. Grant us the strength to leave behind our comfort and security, to take up the cross of our Saviour and follow where he leads, for his name's sake. Amen.
Amen.
At this point I want to think about a short talk about the greatest sacrifice, the greatest sacrifice. We're thinking about sacrifice this morning, particularly as we remember those who have given their lives in war to help preserve our freedom. But I want to tell you about the one who made the greatest sacrifice for our sakes, and that is God himself. Let's think about a verse from the Bible that shows why Jesus, the Son of God, gave up his life on the cross to rescue us. Romans 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Now, the wages of sin is death. Let's think about wages. When a person does a job for an employer, they expect to be paid for that work. They receive a wage, a sum of money for the job that they have done. Now, here's a £10 note on the screen. If you go into the cinema and use this to buy a ticket to see a film, then the cinema will accept this note as payment. This note is a promise from the chief cashier of the Bank of England to pay the cinema £10 sterling. The picture of the Queen's head on the note is a guarantee of its trustworthiness. But work is not the only thing for which we deserve a wage. God promises that the wages for sin is death. Adam and Eve disobeyed God. They had perfect friendship with God. But after they disobeyed God and so sinned, they had a guilty conscience. And God said they had to leave the Garden of Eden. And although God still cared for them and provided them with what they needed, their relationship with him was not the same. They hid from him. They were frightened of him. And because they felt guilt over the wrong they had done, that's why they hid. And the Bible teaches that we all share in their sin, and we have disobeyed God too. We know what it is to feel guilty for our sins and to try to hide from God or to live our own way without caring about what God thinks. We put our trust in money rather than God, or we do what our friends tell us to do even though we know they pressurize us to do things God would not be happy about. We might be unkind or even envy or bully someone else because we want what they have instead of being content with what God has given us. All these are sins, and they are marks of spiritual death. What shall we receive for our sins against God and others? Well, death. The wages of sin is death. In the Bible, this is not only physical death, but also spiritual. It includes God's judgment on us, and being separated from him forever in a place the Bible calls hell. Sin is very, very serious. How can we be rescued, or as the Bible puts it, saved from this happening to us? Well, the Bible teaches that God has already taken the initiative to save us. The Father and Son agreed together that the Son, Jesus Christ, would come into this world and sacrifice his life for us. so that we could be forgiven of our sins and go to heaven instead of hell when we die. At the cross, Jesus, who had done no wrong, allowed sinful people to nail him to a cross, and there he bore all our sins. He did this for us, even though we are the guilty, sinful ones. He died the death that you and I deserve. He paid the wages of our sin once and for all. As we have just sung, there was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. This is the ultimate sacrifice, the greatest sacrifice of all. The Father giving up his Son for us, and the Son dying on the cross for you and for me. Now, all those who repent of their sins and believe in Jesus Christ as their Saviour are promised the free gift of eternal life from God. Remember the £10 that you gave to the cinema? Well, they look at that note and then they will let you in. And that note guarantees the bank will pay the amount the cinema charges for you to go in. So too, if you have put your trust in Jesus, then the Father welcomes you as if you were his own son. Jesus' death ensures that the Father now receives you, whatever you have done wrong. His Son's death is the payment which ensures you will be received into relationship with him and be received into heaven. It's not anything that you and I deserve. It's because Jesus has died for us. But like any gift, it must be received, or we are still going to have to pay for our sins. Have you said sorry to God for your sins? Have you put your faith in Jesus? If not, then I would urge you to do it straight away. Remember, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Well, we're going to worship the Lord with the words of the hymn God of Glory, which is number 191.
We lift our hearts to you, and we God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Jesus Christ, who died, more than that, he was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. May the Lord bless his reading for that word.
Thank you very much, Anne. We're going to worship the Lord again in song, remembering his sacrifice, but also his victory. We're going to sing, first of all, Meekness and Majesty, which is number 465.
Yeah.
so what we're going to do now is sing a song that I think we've sung before. Well, we might have sung the chorus, because you will only find the chorus of this song in Mission Praise. Today you're going to hear the whole song, My Rich Mullins. And what I propose is that we sing the chorus and we let Rich Mullins sing the verses. Okay, so you, sounds good, doesn't it? Okay. So we let Rich Mullins sing the verses and we join in the chorus. The words will come up on the screen. Anyway, let's just remind ourselves of the chorus.
Amen.
The righteous man, though he die early, will be at rest, for old age is not honoured for length of time, not measured by number of years. But understanding is grey hair for men, and a blameless life is ripe old age. The righteous live forever, and their reward is with the Lord. The Most High takes care of them. Therefore they will receive a glorious crown and a beautiful diadem from the hand of the Lord, because with his right hand he will cover them, and with his arm he will shield them. Would you please stand? Friends, let us remember in silence before God all those who have died in war. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
Amen.
Almighty Father, you call your children to live as brothers and sisters in love and harmony, and have given your Son to be our Saviour, the Prince of Peace. Grant that we, who are called by his name, may yield our lives to your service, and strive for reconciliation, understanding, and peace in all our relationships, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Father of mercies and God of all comfort, we pray this day for all those who continue to suffer because of war, the widows, orphans, and all who are bereaved, the wounded, crippled, deaf, dumb, and blinded, the shell-shocked and mentally deranged, the refugees without home, work, or country. Grant to them all your healing and strength, your help and consolation, and let it be mediated wherever possible through us. For Jesus Christ's sake, we ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Would you please be seated? Well, we're actually going to sing another hymn. So you can be standing again in a moment. But Fight the Good Fight, which is number 143.
Thank you.
But dear Lord, we do again thank you for the great sacrifice that you made for our saints. We pray now that you'll speak to us through your word. Amen. Well, today I'm going to speak to you from an article called Wartime Miracles and a National Scandal. The article is written in the form of a sermon by a minister called W.B. Grant. And I think it really has a powerful message for Remembrance Sunday. And that's why I'm taking this rather unusual step of sharing someone else's sermon with you today. For simplicity, I'll pretend as if I were Reverend Grant. In other words, I will use his words. So, wartime miracles and a national scandal. The World War II testimonies of six of the most senior figures, including Eisenhower, Churchill, and leading military officers, reveal God's protection of the nation in response to prayer and faithfulness. But if they could see the state of the nation today, what might they wish us to know? There is an old story of two spiders, one the mother and another her son. The story goes that mother spider made a lovely home in her web, and she suspended this web from a single strand hanging from a tree branch far above. One day her son paid a visit. As he surveyed her home, he noticed this single strand seemingly ascending into empty space. Thinking it useless, he cut it, and to his horror, the whole web fell and was destroyed. The thread of faith. The spiritual lesson behind this story is very simple. Many people today look back upon the wartime generations and regard their faithful belief in Almighty God as something really strange and peculiar. As a minister, I've often heard comments like, oh, Granny and Grandad went to church every Sunday. I don't know why. Or, Granny read her Bible every day. How boring that must have been. They might occasionally add, we have no interest in anything like that. Being religious is a waste of time. Now, it is this kind of attitude which has led many people today to cut the thread of faith in God, which supported previous generations. And now, to their horror, the whole structure of our society has collapsed in a myriad of social and moral problems. That thread, that faith in God, that hope in Him, that eternal light which could never be extinguished, is precisely what kept previous generations going through war and bloodshed. Today's generation has largely dismissed this faith as being unimportant, and we see the ruinous results all around. It is often said that the past is like another country with regard to belief and behaviour. And I am reminded of this truth time and again as I study the attitudes of those who experience wartime. As a minister for over 30 years, I have immersed myself in researching wartime events from both world wars. I have personally talked to those who served in the trenches during the First World War, and I have talked to numerous ex-service personnel from the Second World War. It has been a unique privilege to have been able to do this, and I can say with total conviction that an underlying faith in Almighty God was absolutely integral to keeping people in this country strong and keeping them going. They believed that God was real, and in turn they witnessed profound examples of God being at work in this world of chaos which men have made. Dunkirk and divine intervention. An example of just how strong and widespread this belief in God really was can be seen in the response of people when King George VI called for a national prayer day at the time of the Dunkirk crisis. In May 1940, when France had fallen and the British army was trapped at Dunkirk, where they were to be annihilated, King George VI called for a national day of prayer to plead for divine intervention. Now, so widespread and so deep was faith in God that literally millions of people flocked into churches to pray. The special service held in Westminster Abbey was so inundated that there is a famous photograph showing a queue a quarter of a mile long as people desperately tried to get in to pray. That's how important and how widespread faith was in that generation. Was in that generation. They knew God was real, and they knew he could be petitioned through heartfelt prayer. The result of that National Day of Prayer was, of course, the miracle of Dunkirk, without which none of us will be here today. History shows that the faith of that generation was regularly rewarded. Only those who studied the events of the Second World War can fully appreciate just how close we came to losing the war and losing our freedom. The facts show that at numerous crisis points, when it seemed all was lost, the people of this nation witnessed God's hand at work, changing what should have been the natural outcome of an event into a deliverance. More than human planning. Recently, I came across an article written by no less than the head of the British and American planning staff, the body responsible for planning D-Day and the liberation of Europe. He was in a unique position of knowing fully what was happening on the war front. His name was Lieutenant General Sir Frederick Morgan, and he wrote this article 2 years after the end of the war, as he looked back on events, and these are his words. Miracles still happen. How many of them have we not seen enacted before our eyes in this past few years? There was Dunkirk and its flat, calm sea. Who planned that? We saw no way out, barring a miracle. Then came the miracle. 2 years later, the British and American military convoy was sailing in order to land in North Africa. All the enemy submarines were on the lookout. A breathtaking moment came when a U-boat caught sight of the tall ship of one convoy. The rest of the convoy was obscured by a squall that appeared to be travelling along with our ships, providing cover. The result was that the Nazi observer thought that what he saw was merely worthy of routine report. Then, just as General Patton was due to land on the Casablanca beaches, open to the full Atlantic swell, at the very moment it seemed inevitable that the whole affair must be called off, the wind changed from onshore to offshore and let small craft land successfully. There was surely more than human planning here too. Then there was the miracle of D-Day in 1944 with a last-minute change in the weather. The history of our theatres of war tell of many similar happenings. When you read the reflections of those who were in authority, individuals who had direct knowledge as to what was really happening behind the scenes during the war, they all describe the same thing, an overwhelming sense of divine intervention at critical moments. We have a guardian. Wartime Prime Minister Winston Churchill is another example. He, like Morgan, knew everything that was going on. And toward the end of 1942, as the tide turned in the war, he wrote, "I sometimes have a feeling of interference. I want to stress that. I have a feeling sometimes that some guiding hand has interfered. I have a feeling that we have a guardian, because we have a great cause, and we shall have that guardian so long as we serve that cause faithfully." Altered sequence of events. Then there is the testimony of Air Chief Marshal Sir Hugh Dowding. He was the actual Commander-in-Chief of Fighter Command during the Battle of Britain. He knew all too well what was really going on and how desperate things were. After the battle was over, he wrote, "I pay homage to those gallant boys who gave their all so that our nation might live. But I say with absolute conviction that I can trace the intervention of God, not only in the battle itself, but in the events leading up to it. At the end of the battle, one had the feeling that there had been some special divine intervention to alter some sequence of events which would otherwise have occurred." Mortars, very present help. But what about the account of General Sir William Doby, who was governor of Malta during its siege, which began in 1940? It was absolutely vital that this outpost be held from the Germans, because its capture was key to gaining control of the Mediterranean Sea. Looking back, he wrote this: God, in his mercy, answered our prayers, and in the 2 years or more of the siege, his help was very obvious and very real. God's protecting hand was so much in evidence that on a number of occasions, officers came up to me and said quite spontaneously, "Do you know, sir, I think someone up there," pointing upwards, "has been helping us today." And such conversations took place not once, not twice, but a number of times. Dobie was so overwhelmed with the sense of God's help during the siege that he later wrote a book about it entitled A Very Present Help. Eisenhower's Almighty and Merciful God. Then there is the testimony of General Eisenhower. Eisenhower was none other than the supreme commander of the Allied forces, responsible for D-Day and the ultimate liberation of Europe. And like the others I have quoted, he too held a unique position where he knew everything that was going on. In June 1952, as he reflected on the events of D-Day, he stated, "This day, 8 years ago, I made the most agonising decision of my life. I had to decide to postpone by at least 24 hours the most formidable array of fighting ships and of fighting men that ever was launched across the sea against a hostile shore. The consequences of that decision at that moment could not have been foreseen by anyone. If there was nothing else in my life to prove the existence of an almighty and merciful God, the events of the next 24 hours did it. The greatest break in a terrible outlay of weather occurred the next day and allowed that great invasion to proceed, with losses far below those we had anticipated. This is the Lord's doing." When the war in Europe ended in May 1945 with the surrender of Germany, Field Marshal Montgomery, Commander-in-Chief of the 21st Army Group, sent a personal message to all the troops under his command. In his position as Commander-in-Chief, he too had knowledge about what had really gone on during the war. My uncle served under him and he passed on to me a copy of his personal message. The opening part of the message sent to all troops goes like this: "On this day of victory in Europe, I feel I would like to speak to all who have served and fought with me during the last few years. We all have a feeling of great joy and thankfulness that we have been preserved to see this day. We must remember to give praise and thankfulness where it is due." And then he cites Psalm 118:23. "This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvellous in our eyes." So, I have quoted from six highly intelligent and gifted individuals who held the most profound key positions during the Second World War. These people were the most informed and knowledgeable of any in the country, and as they reflected on events, they recognised that Almighty God had answered the prayers of the nation as it pleaded for his intervention. The wartime generation knew God was real. They knew that he would listen to prayer offered in a spirit of humility and repentance, and in turn, their faith was rewarded with deliverance. From the foxholes of Luxembourg, just as there were great and mighty deliverances through wartime, there were also numerous examples of small and localised instances of divine help. Listen to this personal letter written from a soldier to his mother. The soldier was called Joel. He was serving in Patton's Third Army, and he describes how the entire platoon narrowly escaped being wiped out as it faced the Germans in Luxembourg. He wrote this: "One of my best friends, Tom, with his whole platoon, was pinned down by mortar and artillery fire. They were given the order to move, but they couldn't because the enemy had full view of them from a hill and were zeroing their fire on them accurately. Tom is the most conscientious Christian boy I've ever met in the services. He knew something had to be done to save the 50 men. He crawled from his foxhole and looked things over. Seeing the hopelessness of the situation, he lay down behind a tree and prayed earnestly for God to help him. This is true, Mother. After he prayed, a mist or fog rolled down between the two hills, and the whole platoon got out of their foxholes and escaped. They reorganised in a little town behind the mines, where there was a church building. They all went in and knelt down to pray and thank the Lord, and then they asked Tom to take the service. This is true, Mother, and it just shows how much prayer can mean. If that was not an answer to prayer, I don't know what is. Why has God preserved us? In April 1945, the Bishop of Chelmsford, Dr. Henry Wilson, wrote in the press, "If ever a great nation was on the point of supreme and final disaster, and yet was saved and reinstated, it was ourselves." That is a fact which should be written on the souls of all of us in an indelible letters of fire. It does not require an exceptionally religious mind to detect in all this the hand of God. It has been a miracle, and the person who does not recognise that is impervious to the deeper significance of events. Challenging people as to why we have been saved, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. William Temple, said in his sermon at St. Paul's Cathedral on the Battle of Britain, Sunday in 1943, "Why has God preserved us? We may and we must believe that he who led our fathers in ways so strange and has preserved our land in a manner so marvellous has a purpose for us to serve in the preparation for his perfect kingdom." The single strand broken. It is plain to see that between the wartime generations and today's generation, the thread of faith is broken. In matters of faith, it really is like a different country between then and now. Just imagine if those individuals whom I have quoted, individuals who have personally witnessed God's intervention firsthand, were by some miraculous means sent back to speak to our nation today. What do you think they would say? Their message would surely be, "This nation must take Almighty God seriously, and people must take the Bible seriously. They must carefully apply the Lord's will, as revealed in Scripture, to their own personal lives, because faith does matter. It makes all the difference. It is the single strand that holds the whole web secure." But, along with this message, I think they would also have a question to ask of those holding positions of influence. They would surely want to know why the events they witnessed, which were so profound and are so well documented, are at the same time so rarely talked about, or even mentioned in churches, parliament, or schools today. This is the national scandal and a betrayal of the very freedoms and democracy which this generation claims to appreciate. Faith is so important after all, that if it hadn't been for the faithfulness of the wartime generation praying to Almighty God, none of today's generation would ever have been born. This truth needs to be broadcast in every church and taught in every school right across this nation of ours. Thank you, Granny, for reading your Bible every day and going to church. Your faith and the faith of your generation meant that I could live. What God dramatically did for that generation, he can also do for ours. Our nation urgently needs his help and protection. May we, like the wartime generation before us, turn to God in a true spirit of repentance and plead for divine help. In Chronicles 7:14, he promises, "If people humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins, and heal their land." If our nation once again sought God's help, as it did during wartime, now, just as then, miracles of blessing and protection would begin to happen. Amen. Amen. But we're going to sing our final hymn together, which is the marvellous hymn Stuart Townend has written called In Christ Alone, which is number 107. Bring us at length into his eternal rest. Amen.
Amen. Amen.